Shall we turn to the book of Leviticus? Book of Leviticus, chapter 16. The book of Leviticus, chapter 16. We'll read from verses 1 to 20, and also a few verses from the end. We'll read all these passages because it is God's word, God's holy word, documented with such clarity and with such carefulness from in all the ages. And this passage especially speaks about, you know, the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's a very, very important type of the Lord Jesus Christ and his death. And so let us read it and be very attentive to the words, because this is God's word. Chapter 16, verses 1. And when it starts, it starts with, you know, the prohibitions of the day. This passage is about the Day of Atonement, and it starts with the, you know, the prohibitions that the Lord puts up. In verse 1 and 2, we read about that. Now the Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered profane fire before the Lord and died. And the Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron your brother not to come at just any time into the holy place inside the veil, before the mercy seat which is on the ark, lest he die, for I will appear in the cloud above the mercy seat. Thus Aaron shall come into the holy place with the blood of a young bull as a sin offering, and of a ram as a burnt offering." And now from these verses on, we read of the provisions that are needed for the sacrifice. "He shall put the holy linen tunic and the linen trousers on his body. He shall be girded with a linen sash, and with the linen turban he shall be attired. These are holy garments. Therefore he shall wash his body in water and put them on. And he shall take from the congregation of the children of Israel two kids of the goats as a sin offering, and one ram as a burnt offering. And Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house. He shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Then Aaron shall cast lots for the two goats, one lot for the Lord, and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat on which the Lord's lot fell and offer it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make atonement upon it, and to let it go as a scapegoat into the wilderness. And Aaron shall bring the bull of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house, and he shall kill the bull of as the sin offering, which is for himself. Then he shall take the censer full of burning coals of fire from the altar before the Lord, with his hands full of sweet incense beaten fine, and bring it inside the veil. And he shall put the incense on the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is on the testimony, lest he die. Then he shall take some of the blood of the bull and sprinkle it with his finger on the mercy seat on the east side, and before the mercy seat he shall sprinkle some blood with his finger seven times. Then he shall kill the goat of the sin offering, which is for the people. Bring its blood inside the veil. Do with that blood as he did with the blood of the bull, and sprinkle it on the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. So he shall make atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, and because of their transgressions for all their sins. And so he shall do for the tabernacle of meeting, which remains among them in the midst of their uncleanness. There shall be no man in the tabernacle of meeting when he goes in to make atonement in the holy place until he comes out, that he may make atonement for himself, for his household, and for all the assembly of Israel. And he shall go out to the altar that is before the Lord, and make atonement for it, and shall take some of the blood of the bull and some of the blood of the goat, and put it on the horns of the altar all around. Then he shall sprinkle some of the blood on it with his finger seven times, cleanse it and consecrate it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. And when he has made an end of atoning for the holy place, the tabernacle of meeting, and the altar, he shall bring the live goat. And we should also read from verse 29 onwards until the end of the chapter. This shall be a statute forever for you. In the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, you shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether a native of your own country or a stranger who dwells among you. For on that day the priest shall make atonement for you to cleanse you, that you may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. It is a Sabbath of solemn rest for you, and you shall afflict your souls. It is a statute forever. And the priest who is anointed and consecrated to be and consecrated to minister as priest in his father's place shall make atonement and put on the linen garments, the holy garments. Then he shall make atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make atonement for the tabernacle of meeting and for the altar, and he shall make atonement for the priests and for all the people of the assembly. This shall be an everlasting statute for you to make atonement for the children of Israel for all their sins once a year. And he did as the Lord commanded Moses. May the Lord bless, add his blessings to the reading of his word. Over the past year, I've been listening to a lot of messages, and I found this a message on this subject very interesting, and made a few notes, and may have added some of my own thoughts. And so, what we hope to listen to today from the Word of God is a fruit of all that. So this talks about this passage talks about the Day of Atonement, and it's a very, very symbolic passage. There are a lot of rituals that are very, very clearly prescribed by God that the high priest has to perform, and it's very, very a lot of procedure involved in all of this, as we read, and it's very systematic and orderly conduct in the tabernacle on this day. As we know, this was the day of atonement was the only day when the high priest was able to enter the most holy place. And many people have this misconception that they were able to enter, the high priest was able to enter only once. While that is true, it is true only of the day. He was able to enter only on that day. But if we paid attention to the passage that we were reading, on this day itself, the high priest entered multiple times. He entered three times at least into the tabernacle. As you see in verse 12, verse 13, 14, verse 12, 13, 14, and 15, if we read, he enters first with some kind of incense, and then he enters the second time with the blood of the bull, and then he enters the third time with the blood of the goat. And so it's not just that's a misconception that many people have, and just for the sake of clarity, we should know that it was he entered at least three times into the most holy place on this day. And another misconception people have about this passage is how the high priest was dressed when he entered in. We read about stories like a rope was tied on the legs of the high priest because he's entering a very sacred place, and they're afraid of if he died, what would happen, or something like that. Or there are other people who say, he used to wear clothes that had bells on them, so that whenever he moved inside the most holy place, they could hear. And if the sound of bells stopped, it means that the high priest was no longer alive. But if we read in verse 4 especially, we read of the exact dress that the high priest had to wear. Holy linen tunic, which is a coat. Holy linen and the linen trousers on his body, which were garments that were unseen. The King James Version calls it bleachers. He shall be girded with a linen sash or a girdle or a belt, something that holds the coat together. and a linen turban, a mitre, on his head. The common word from all these four objects of clothing are linen. There was nothing else that the high priest wore but linen garments on this day. So any misconception of, you know, he wore, sure, he had those other garments, or the garments of great gold and jewelry and big precious stones and you know, breastplate and a robe that had bells on it, but those were worn all the other days. But on this specific day, when he entered the most holy place, the high priest entered with only linen garments, and that is a very significant thing, as we shall see a little later on. Let's look at you know, the prohibitions that God imposes, or the reason why the Day of Atonement was established. Now, the reason why for this Day of Atonement and for every other sacrifice is, there's one common theme, is that it pointed to the Lord Jesus Christ and his death. Everything in this Bible, in fact, points to the Lord Jesus Christ, and so does this chapter. So if you look at it, the general reason for the Day of Atonement being there is it was a prototype of that great act on the cross of Calvary. But if we look at a specific reason, we read in chapter 16 and verse 1, it says, Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered profane fire before the Lord and died. Now this event is documented in Leviticus chapter 10. And if you read that, it's a very significant thing that happens. I'll read from verse 23 onwards of chapter 9. This is just after the consecration of the high priest, and you know, the first offerings were offered, and it's a great moment of great joy and of great reverence, because we'll read in verse 23, and Moses and Aaron went into the tabernacle of meeting. That itself is very, very significant. If you read the first few verses of Leviticus, God was inside the tabernacle and everyone was outside. Nobody was allowed to enter, put a single step in. But once the offerings were established, once God was satisfied and pleased, the people had access, not all the people, but Moses and Aaron, they had access into the tabernacle of meeting. It's the first time they are entering this great structure that was given by God. And Moses and Aaron went into the tabernacle of meeting and came out and blessed the people. Then the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. And this is a great event in the life of the children of Israel. They had seen the glory of God. In fact, the terrorizing presence of God on the Mount of where the Ten Commandments are given, the Mount Sinai. And then we see in Exodus chapter 24 of how a few people, 70 elders, Moses, Aaron, and Aaron's children, Nadab and Abihu, entering into God's presence on the mountain. And they initially, God tells them in Exodus chapter 24, do not come close. But then after a sacrifice is offered, we see how they enter in. And not only that, in Exodus 24 says that they sat down and they ate bread and they did drink. And they saw the God of Israel. That is a sentence that is used there. They saw the God of Israel. And Nadab and Abihu were two people who were in that group, that they saw the God of Israel. They saw his glory. And there are some excellent phrases that are used there, how they saw sapphire and jewels like that were created, almost a piece of heaven that was in front of their eyes on this earth. And that great welcoming glory of God was something that they observed. And after that, the glory is appearing commonly to all the people over here. We read, then the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. And verse 24, and fire came out from before the Lord and consumed the burnt offering and the fat on the altar. When all the people saw it, they shouted and fell on their faces. And this is another great event where God is accepting that sacrifice, that most sweet-smelling savor, that sacrifice, the burnt offering and the fat that is on the altar. God is accepting it with fire that comes out, divine fire that comes out from heaven, from the heavens itself. And then we read in chapter 10, verse 1, then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, this is immediately after that, each took a censer and put fire in it and put incense on it and offered profane fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. So fire went out from before the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. And then we read, and Moses said to Aaron, this is what the Lord spoke, saying, by those who came near me, I must be regarded as holy, and before all the people I must be glorified. And then we read that sentence that says, so Aaron held his peace. Aaron, seeing his own two children consumed by the fire of God, the very fire that, so it, the 9 verse 24, the first phrase, that the fire came out from before the Lord, and chapter 10 verse 2, fire went out from the Lord, both are the same phrase that is in the original text. The same fire that consumed the burnt offering, that was welcoming of, that showed the great pleasure that God had in those burnt offerings, that same fire goes and consumes and devours the children of Aaron. And now we don't know exactly how they disobeyed God's command. It just says they offered profane fire. If you read that verse in chapter 10, verse 1, that's probably a function that was only reserved for the high priest. Or maybe they would have entered the holiest of all, and that's why, you know, the Day of Atonement was mentioned as a prescription for that. We don't know exactly what happened, but one thing that we can see underlying thing is that Nadab and Abihu took liberties that were not meant for them. God's commandment was very clear that nobody should approach, and yet they approach without any, without thinking twice. They approach the presence of God, and then God consumes them. And then that's why God himself says, by those who come near me, I must be regarded as holy, and before all the people, I must be glorified. And so that's a very important lesson that we can learn from, you know, the life of Nadab and Abihu, that the presence of God should not be treated lightly. That we do live in the age of grace, but the same God who consumed these two children of Aaron is the God whom we worship today. And it is only through the mercies of his Son, the work of his Son on the cross of Calvary, that we have access. But we should never take that access for granted. I believe that it is because they were among one of the people who saw that great glory, that welcoming glory of God in Exodus 24. And then when they see that glory again, they may have just approached God's presence in a manner that was not pleasing to him, and God devours them with fire. And so we see the great tragedy that happens in the life of Aaron. Throughout the book of Leviticus, although Aaron is the high priest, we see God only talks to Moses. The Lord never speaks to Aaron with all those commands. It always says the Lord spoke to Moses. The Lord spoke to Moses. The Lord revealed this to Moses. So in spite of the fact that Aaron was the anointed high priest, we see how there's a breakdown in the function of the high priest when it was instituted itself. And that shows the feebleness of the high priest, the Aaronic high priest order. And we are so thankful that the Lord Jesus is there who is the high priest of the order of Melchizedek, a completely different line. And that high priesthood is not being broken. And God reveals himself through the Lord Jesus Christ to us even today, as Hebrews chapter 1 says. Coming back to Leviticus chapter 16, verse 1, it says, now the Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered profane fire before the Lord and died. And the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron your brother not to come at just any time into the holy place inside the veil before the mercy seat, which is on the ark, lest he die. For I will appear in the cloud above the mercy seat. And so this is a matter of great grace that the Lord doesn't say, do not appear before me at all. He could have very well said that because the children of Aaron displeased him. That Levitical line the line that was called out to serve him, it was the line that displeased him, and a great tragedy that took place on that day. Because of that, the Lord would have been completely right in saying that, do not come into the holy place, most holy place ever. But here we see how the Lord says, he do not come at just any time, but is now proceeding to give a detailed procedure to enter most holy place. And so that shows how God always wants to commune with his children. We who once were dead in our sins and our trespasses, he has made alive. And we have all, most of us, have trusted in that saving grace and have become children of God. And yet, we find that we are weak and we sin because of our flesh. And yet the Lord doesn't consume us. He allows us to come into his presence. And we who are forgiven, we who have our hands and our hearts and our minds purified through the blood of the Lord Jesus, have this great privilege of communing with him through the bread and the wine every Sunday. And so that is a great picture of grace, and something that shows us that the Lord is not does not want to isolate himself from mankind. He is a God who wants to fellowship, and he is a God who is willing to give detailed procedure on how to enter his presence. And we are thankful that in this day and age we do not have to follow such procedures, because it is the Lord Jesus, it is the blood of the Lord Jesus through whom we enter. Now this atonement, the word atonement is a very, very interesting word, and a lot of scholars have written many things about it. I have not read every one of them, so I'm not somebody who is worthy of commenting on it. Many people say that, the majority says that the word atonement means covering, and that when this day of atonement had concluded, or when the animal sacrifices had been made, and when the scapegoat had been let loose, that all the sins of the children of Israel were covered. But that was, the covering is always temporary, and that the Old Testament, there was no provision for complete forgiveness. And to some extent, if we read Romans chapter 3, we get an idea for that. But there is that, this is a debate how, then how could any Old Testament saint be a child of God, and how will any Old Testament saint have their sins actually forgiven, and how can they actually enter God's presence? There's that debate that always goes on. There's another meaning for atonement that some people hold on to, which means wiping clean. And it's a very interesting study, but I just thought I would speak on that and make us aware of such a difference. But one thing is for certain, that our sins are not being covered. We know that our sins are forgiven, and they have been forgiven completely. Romans chapter 8, I think, talks about God condemning sins in the flesh, the flesh of the Lord Jesus. He didn't forgive, or he didn't forget them, or he didn't bury them anywhere. He condemned sin in the flesh, and one final solution to the sin of mankind was achieved in the Lord Jesus, and we are very, very thankful for that today. Another reason that we see for the Day of Atonement, if we read from verse 16 onwards, we can read one word always is uncleanness. Verse 16 says, because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, because of their transgressions for all their sins, and so he shall do for the tabernacle of meeting which remains among them in the midst of their uncleanness. Uncleanness so many times. And then verse 19 also says the same thing. Cleanse it and consecrate it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. Verse 22, the goat shall bear on itself all their iniquities to an uninhabited land. And so that's another reason for the Day of Atonement, is that while there were sacrifices that were offered daily, there was still an uncleanness that was present all around, and that's something that could not be removed. You know, if we read chapter 10, we start reading about the chapter starts with the death of the sons of Aaron. But the Lord addresses this death only in chapter 16, verse 1. And in between that, there are several laws concerning how to deal with uncleanness. And so we see how, before he addresses the situation of, Nadab and Abihu, the Lord is making aware of this, of the uncleanness that is present in the camp and in the people. You know, in verse 11, in chapter 11, he talks about the uncleanness of their diet. In chapter 12, and it talks about the uncleanness of their descendants. This is the uncleanness in childbearing and all those things. In chapter 13 and 14, he talks about the uncleanness present in the diseases are all around the children of Israel. And chapter 15, he talks about the uncleanness of their bodily discharges. And so, after the death of these two individuals, the Lord keeps on reminding the children of Israel of their uncleanness. And then, in verse 16, he addresses that death. And so, that the Day of Atonement is like a solution to that, to all the uncleanness. The children of Israel had to obey the sacrificial routine that was prescribed. But apart from that, there was a global day of sacrifice, a Day of Atonement that happened on the 7th month, on the 10th day, which was needed to cleanse the children of Israel, to cleanse the camp. And not only the camp, to cleanse the tabernacle itself from all the uncleanness that surrounded the holy place, that surrounded the camp. And so we see that was the reason for the Day of Atonement. And so the reasons for the Day of Atonement talk about the demand the demands for the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. He had to die because of our sins. Those were the demands that were there for the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. We see that it was death, it was the subject of death in chapter 16 verse 1 that causes the Lord to address how we can, how the children of Israel could avoid death by when they approached him. And so we who were dead in our sins and our trespasses, God addressed that, and through the Lord Jesus Christ. So that speaks about the demands of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our sin, our trespasses, all our uncleanness and our transgressions, that demanded the death of someone who is holy, and that is why the Lord Jesus Christ died for us. And so we see through the establishment of the Day of Atonement, the demands of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ are clearly seen. And then we read in verse 4 of the provisions that were needed. Verse 3 talks about the animals that are needed. It talks about a young bull for a sin offering, and a ram for a burnt offering. And that is for the priest. Verse 5 talks about two kids of the goats for a sin offering and one ram for a burnt offering, which was the provision for all the children of Israel. After that, we also read the provisions for the priest, the high priest, the garments that he had to wear. And it's very interesting as we read in verse 4, he shall put the holy linen tunic and the linen trousers on his body. He shall be girded with a linen sash, that's a belt, and with the linen turban he shall be attired. These are holy garments. Therefore, he shall wash his body in water and put them on. And this is a very significant change from all the other priestly priestly orders in sacrifices. In no other sacrifice do we read that the priest had to do all these things. One point that we can see is when it comes to the Day of Atonement, the priest is arrayed in a simple robe, simple linen tunic, completely white. There's nothing special about it. There's no jewelry. There's no shining that comes forth. If we read about the original priestly garments, there are some verses in Exodus 28. We won't go to that, but the phrase that is used there is that the priestly garments were created for glory and for beauty. These two were the reasons for the adorning priestly garments, the ornamental priestly garments that consisted of, you know, the breastplate filled with jewels, and an ephod that had jewelry, big stones of precious stones on the shoulders, a robe of blue, and so many other things that it was very, very ornamental. But when it came to the Day of Atonement, we see how the priest was arrayed in just plain fine linen. And that speaks about the Lord Jesus Christ and how he left his heavenly glories and came into this world, how he veiled his glory and came into this world as a simple man, and walked the streets, in and around Jerusalem. And then the garments itself speak about very, very interesting parts in the life of the Lord Jesus, or attributes of the Lord Jesus. We read of linen trousers, a linen belt or a sash, and a linen turban. That speaks of the threefold purity of the Lord Jesus. He knew no sin. The linen turban is something that speaks about that. He did no sin. The girdle, the belt, the linen belt speaks about that. And the trousers, something that were unseen because of everything that was covering it, speaks about how the Lord Jesus Christ had no sin, absolutely no sin in him. And so this speaks about the dignity of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just that he had to die for our sins, but he needed to be that holy and that sanctified sacrifice for our sins. And we read about those verses that I mentioned. In him was no sin, the one who knew no sin and the one who did no sin, throughout the New Testament. And we read about how the Lord Jesus met all the righteous requirements of God's law, that one sinless and spotless, the stainless sacrifice for our sake. We read of how he was tempted by the devil. He was tempted to sin by the devil, but he could never be tempted by sin because in him was no sin. And we are so thankful for that the Lord Jesus met the great demands of God in living a holy and righteous and acceptable life, completely devoid of sin in this world. And so those three garments speak about specifically the sinless nature of the Lord Jesus. And then we read about the offerings itself. We read about the bull for the high priest and his family, and we read about the kid goats. If we look at this is a great picture of the life of the Lord Jesus. Verse 6 says, Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house. And verse 7 says, he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Now that word offer in verse 6 is actually the same as present in verse 7. So he doesn't kill the bull first. All these animals are presented at the door of the tabernacle before God. And later on we read how the priest himself kills those animals. But before the killing was the presentation of these animals in front of the door of the tabernacle. these animals that were without any blemishless animals, we read of the goats as being kids of the goats, blemishless young goats, acceptable to God as sacrifices. That speaks about, again, the sinless nature of the Lord Jesus. And them being presented before the door of the tabernacle is a picture of how the Lord Jesus was presented before his ministry on this earth, after his baptism. So we see great pictures of the Lord Jesus in these animals. We read of after his baptism how as if it were he were presented on the banks of the river Jordan, and God himself, the Father himself, approving of his life thus far, and approving that he is the Son of God himself, my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And so we see how these animals are presented before the door of the tabernacle of meeting. And so all this speaks of the dignity in the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, that sinless, spotless offering for our sake, the Lord Jesus himself dying on the cross of Calvary for us. Then we read about the procedure involved in the sacrifice. Verse 8 onwards, he says, "Then Aaron shall cast lots for the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat on which the Lord's lot fell and offer it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make atonement upon it and to let it go as a scapegoat into the wilderness." So we read here again, this is another specific speciality of this Day of Atonement, lots being cast before a sacrifice. No other sacrifice we read of where lots were cast. And in one interesting verse about lots being cast is in Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 33. And this is a good verse. We may have read it and know it, but it's a good verse to remember whenever we are talking about lots in the Bible. Proverbs chapter 16 verse 33 says, "The lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord." And so, we talk about lots being cast, we think it is something random, something that is by chance, but whenever the lot is cast, we must remember that it is the Lord's decision that is being executed. In the case of the goats that were presented, one of the goats was a scapegoat and the other goat was killed and for the Lord. And the lot was cast. To the people it may have looked like, oh, it's by chance, one of the two could have got it. But the Lord had already determined which goat is for him and which goat is to be set loose as a scapegoat. And that talks about how the Lord Jesus was chosen, the chosen one before the foundations of the world, to be the perfect the sacrifice for our sake. It was in the predeterminate counsel of God that the Lord Jesus be that great sacrifice for our sake. If you read Acts chapter 2 and verse 23, there's that wonderful phrase that Peter uses. Acts chapter 2 and verse 23, and it says, "Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God." If you read from verse 22 onwards, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands and crucified and put to death." And so there we clearly see how Peter is emphasizing the fact that it was in God's foreknowledge and God's counsel that the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross. It was not a work of man. Men treated him violently that day and seized him and scourged him and finally nailed him to a cross. But none of that was done without the foreknowledge and counsel of God. And so the casting of the lots, although it appears random, it emphasizes the fact that the Lord is the one who knows which goat is going to be his and which goat is going to be killed. And so a great picture of how the Lord Jesus himself was in the predetermined counsel of God, chosen to be that great sacrifice for our sake. We are almost out of time, so we saw the casting of the lots, and then we'll not read the verses, but the other verses speak about so the casting of the lots represents, you know, the determination of the Lord, the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was completely and fully determined by God, and it was not a random act or an act that was committed by men themselves, but it was completely and fully in the foreknowledge of God that it was done, the determination of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And afterwards we read of the far-reaching dimensions of the death of the Lord Jesus in the verses that come later on. We read of how it was not just the most holy place on which the activities happened, but the blood had to be sprinkled on the mercy seat, and then after that the high priest came out and came into the holy place itself and applied the blood there itself. If we read in verse 16, that's what it speaks about. Shall make atonement for the holy place. It's not the most holy place, but the holy place. The work has been finished. The blood has been sprinkled on the mercy seat, and the wrath of God has been pacified. And then when he comes out into the holy place, he makes atonement for it with that same blood, for the purification of the tabernacle and the holy place. And then he doesn't just stop there. He comes out and applies the blood on the altars, the brazen altar that is present in the court. And so the threefold activity that is there, it shows the far-reaching effects, the dimensions of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was pleasing to God, which shows how his blood that was shed on the mercy, his blood that was shed, and the blood that was applied on the mercy seat mirror each other. And so not only was it pleasing to God, but it also purified, it also worked for purification. It purified us of our sins and cleansed us completely. And so it's a great picture of that twofold work of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just the fact that our sins were forgiven or our sins were taken away is not enough, but it had to bring pleasure to God. It had to pacify the wrath of God, and that is what we see, how the blood that is applied or sprinkled on the mercy seat pacifies the wrath of God. And it's a great picture again of that twofold work that the death of the Lord Jesus Christ has achieved. We read of in verse 12 of another small activity before the application of the blood. It talks about, this is the first time the priest enters the most holy place. He enters it with both his hands full, that the plural is mentioned there, his hands full of sweet incense, meet and fine, and he brings it inside the veil. And he puts the incense on the fire before the Lord. The fire is fire that is taken out from the coals from the court and is brought into the most holy place. And there's this cloud of sweet incense that is created that rests on the mercy seat. Now the mercy seat was the place of where the glory of God in that cloud form rested. And here we see how amidst that cloud that represented the Shekinah glory of God is another small cloud that is created with that sweet incense. And that is a great picture of how the death of the Lord Jesus Christ brings sweet incense to God the Father himself, in the presence of God himself. And he goes with two hands full of this incense, and he offers it. And so that's a great picture again of how the life of the Lord and his death on the cross of Calvary brought fragrance, sweet smelling fragrance to that ascended up to God. And so his death was not just meant for you know, the taking away of our sins, but his death, his life and his death were meant to bring glory and pleasure to God himself. And so we see how the Day of Atonement is a great picture, a prototype of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. And it is that great work, the actual Day of Atonement was when the Lord Jesus actually died on the cross. And all this just pointed out, was pointing to the death of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. May we remember these thoughts. There are many other points that we can, you know, glean out of this. We didn't read the scapegoat being taken away. We didn't read many of those things. And there are a lot of beautiful truths that can be expounded from those things. But so for lack of time, we shall stop here. But maybe never forget how the Day of Atonement is a picture of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. It shows the demands for the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. It shows the dignity of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. It shows the determination of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ when the lots were cast, and all the far-reaching dimensions of his death as the blood was sprinkled and the most holy place was sanctified and everything else was sanctified after it. May God bless these words to our hearts.